I'm going to find out how much it costs to host an application with 100 users and ramp it up all the way to 100,000 users. Things will break, devs will cry, and I might lose hair. When your application lives on a server, it's kind of the Wild West at that point. Whatever decides to come your way, you got a handle, partner. Of course, there's only a certain amount of traffic that a certain server can handle. The larger your server, the more it's just going to cost. That's just how it works. And this is where load testing tools come into play.
Ideally, when developing and testing applications, load testing tools are deployed in a controlled environment like a staging server. They enable developers to simulate different levels of user traffic and interactions within your application. And by doing this in a safe testing environment, of course, you can analyze how your system performs under different loads without risking your production environment. For example, when a popular streamer starts to play your game, then you just get a sudden surge in popularity. How do we handle that?
Well, maybe we should give that a try. So let's get started. What makes these types of tests interesting and kind of nuanced is it all heavily depends on the type of application that you have. Sometimes you might have more reads or writes on a database, which will just completely change the way that things are done. But for today, I'm just going to create a simple Twitter-like application where you can post tweets, reply, retweet, like, sign in, etc. The real application that's going to be tested is our API that the front end connects to. We have FastAPI as the framework that I'm going to use to accept the HTTP requests. I'm going to use Postgres to store the data, and it's all going to run in the Docker containers. And I want to make it as simple as possible for each step so I can show you what I'm doing every time I decide to bring on more users. Cool. But obviously, I can't hire a million people to come test this application at once. I don't have that kind of money. So what do I even do to test all of this? A popular one that I've used before is Locust, which is written in Python. It provides a web UI that we can use to track in real time and has a ton of documentation online. But there's also other great options too, like K6 by Grafana. But just because I'm already writing Python and I'm familiar with Locust, we'll be using Locust today. Let's just test our API real quickly here. Overall though, it works pretty well. The Twitter UI looks really good and actually works a lot like the actual Twitter. That'll be $45 billion. I'm going to be using Sevalla, who is the sponsor of today's video, to get myself up and running. Similar to most platforms as a service, it's really easy to deploy using Sevalla. Connect your Git repository and using Nixpack, it already knows how to deploy your application just based off of the files in the repository. And since I'm using a mono repo, I'm going to have to configure the Docker file as is and then just change the directory, but that's very easy. We'll also use the database hosting to host a managed database to monitor the traffic and the analytics specifically on the database reads and writes. And since we have a React application for our front end, we can just use the static site hosting, which is completely free. With Sevalla, you can bring any workload so you can focus on building, use any stack you want, and then just keep on shipping software. If you're like me, then you just want to ship your software without having to worry about things like retention policies, Kubernetes, compliance, cluster maintenance, whatever. It's a big headache for me. So make sure you give Sevalla a try by clicking the link below and supporting the channel. Thank you, Sevalla, for sponsoring today's video. So here's the first deployment that we're going to do. It's a simple server with 0.3 CPUs and 0.3 gigabytes of RAM. Just one instance of that. We're also going to deploy a Postgres 17 database with 0.25 of a CPU and 0.25 gigs of RAM. And ideally, this should fit a lot of traffic, especially for what the application does. So just an initial test, 60 users and about 200 requests per second. This is a bit of a test phase, so I'm going to use Sentry to try and iron out all the details. I can also like LARP being a actual software developer doing this type of stuff and, you know, finding bugs in production. So it kind of feels good for my, you know, crippling self-esteem. As you can see right here, we can see the moment that things go crazy. We spike up to basically all of our limits and then we do a stall in the response time, but then immediately come back down. At first I had about 100 users, but have no requests per minute, but then I found out that this is was wrong on my end, so ignore that. So for 100 active users using the website pretty intensely, it's probably going to cost us about $15 a month. But just realize though that most places will just throw you under their free tier and they wouldn't even charge you this. So on average with this deployment method, I got about 20% CPU usage and we use about 500 to 600 megabytes of memory. On average, we do about 45 milliseconds of latency in that response time. And this is about 70% readers and 30% content creators. But of course, this is whatever, a nothing burger. So let's just ramp up to 1,000 users. Let's take the same deployment and then ramp up the max amount of users to 1,000 and then ramp up to 5 every single second, which gives us about 10 to 15 requests per second. I'm pretty surprised at the results here. By the time we got to about 1,000 users, things just started to slow down again. About 10 seconds worth of response times. But interestingly enough, where we got a lot of pushback was in the liking a tweet endpoint. The funny thing is our Postgres database just still doesn't even give a damn. Like it's nothing. So I went into my code and decided to refactor. I was calling the database multiple times and not even checking my cache. Speaking of cache, this is something that we'll probably have to address later because it's going into memory, but you know, for now, we'll see how far we can push it. So making that little optimization did a little bit better actually, but roughly around the 605 number of users mark, we started to spike up a little bit and never really recovered on the way down. You can see the bottleneck is in the CPU, which to be fair, for half a CPU with 500 active users is pretty insane. And realistically, you can still use the app just fine probably. You're just getting about 10 second response times, which actually is really bad. So yeah, never mind. So let's try vertical scaling here. By adding another $8 a month, we actually just doubled our CPU, which might end up making it a lot better. And also the easiest option. Let's give it a try. This virtual machine just absolutely crushed it. We were able to basically handle the entire load. Now, there was one issue throughout the whole entire thing though, and that was a configuration issue on my end. After about 730 active users, we started to get a little bit of errors because one of the Gunicorn workers, which handles the traffic, kept resetting. This actually also upped the failure rate, but only by a little. To be honest, it didn't even do it by much. At most, we're about 1400 millisecond response time, which again, is not the best, but it's not terrible. In fact, I probably could have downgraded the CPU. Vertical upgrading, it's doing wonders here, but we're definitely pushing it to its machine's limits. Let's do 10,000 users. This one is going to be a significant ramp. Of course, we're having the 10,000 max users, but we're going to ramp up to 35 users per second. So I realized something. I'm actually sending out 30,000 requests per minute, which caused my internet to crash. I don't understand if it was my errors that were coming through, but we had a 54% failure rate. So I have to find a new solution, which is distributed load testing. The way you work is that you have a master server and that is able to control the child servers that then host a different amount of virtual users on it. Locust does this right off the bat. I have to deploy a lot of very powerful servers, which costs a lot of money. So I'm going to find a way to deploy this using different virtual machines. So for 10,000 users, that shouldn't really be much of an issue. But anyway, let's check out what we need to do to get this to work. First, we definitely need to up our memory. Now, rather than scaling vertically again, I actually think we don't even have to use any memory whatsoever. I think we can just use a key value store like Redis, which is a great cache. The cache is what's taking up all the memory anyway, so we can just push it elsewhere. So I'm just going to add a Redis database into Sevalla and just add the environment variable and things are easy. Now, let's give it a try. Now, adding the Redis cache did a lot. We were pushing our VPS to the absolute max. Now, the 10,000 was a bit harder at first to do. I realized that a big issue was in GUnicorn, which serves all the requests. I was using Gthread, which was using the CPU power not as effectively and was all on blocking threads. But then I switched over to Gevent, which now uses async, so things are a lot better. And outside of a small spike, we actively were able to hold at least 10,000 active users on the website with over 800 to 850 requests per second. So this is where we get into horizontal scaling. Now, I've talked about this concept like a billion times on this channel. I feel like it's just been like every other video at this point. Essentially, instead of one large server that you keep growing and growing, you have it traffic towards the same server, but separate. Right now we have one instance of it. We can set it so that once we get to about 80% CPU usage, we can deploy another one and start routing traffic over there. And this actually makes a lot of sense for our scenario, which is a social network. Ideally, you'd want to use a setup like this because you only pay for how much time you use these virtual machines. So if you have an extreme surge of users, you only have to pay for the servers that are being run for that. Just because we're literally 10xing this, I'm going to set a maximum of 5 instances to go off. Ideally, this is when you would start researching when your peak users are starting to come online. And also, we're definitely going to have to upgrade our database here. So I'm just going to vertically scale it this time. The first thing that I want to do is upgrade our virtual machines. Then means that we can have more workers associated with it as well. But I'm going to increase the amount of instances to 10. So 10 instances, we'll see how that goes. Something that's worth noting is that I'm not serving images or anything whatsoever. So a content delivery network would be crucial here if you're serving files or receiving files, but I'm not. Now, to load test 100,000 users, I have to get about 22 machines with 8 cores each in them. And this will hopefully get us close to 100,000 users. Well, hopefully. So for reference, this can be about 35 cents per 1 hour of running per virtual machine. So to do this is going to cost me about $3.50 for about 15 minutes to run this test, which, you know, seems fine, but I don't do things once here, okay? I have to do this a million times. So make sure you subscribe, okay? Especially if you're this far. First of all, getting to 100,000 users was tough. Simulating the amount of users just wasn't easy, so I did a workaround where I just raised the amount of requests per user to make up the difference in users that we might have lost. I ended up just adding a couple more servers as a backup. Then I upgraded those servers as well. But one of the biggest differences was PG Bouncer in the middle of my servers and Postgres to pull in connections. Although there are some hiccups, we were able to get about 10 to 15,000 requests per second, which is awesome. One of the biggest takeaways from this is how hard it is to actually have an application be up 24/7. There's a ton of things that can slow you down or just randomly hop in, like huge spikes in traffic, misconfigurations, and more. And throughout this journey, I learned that there's really not one way to do this. Everything has different types of operations. For example, you might have an application that has a very long process that takes a lot of computing power over time, or you might need a large database that's being called many, many times. All of this requires your own built-in analysis to look at it and determine, where do I scale to meet the demand of my users? And of course, I had a finished app that I never added features onto. So you would have to figure out how to deploy a version of your application with the scale that you have. Almost no matter what, it's going to be an iterative process. Thank you again to Sevalla for sponsoring today's video. Let me know if you want these types of videos and make sure you subscribe for more. Peace out, coders.